in July 21st, 2015, at 7 o'clock p.m. Kathy, can you please call the roll?
Megley.
Here.
Dryden.
Here.
Casper.
Here.
Lot.
Here.
Vogt.
Present.
Here.
Dromel.
Here. Could you please lead us in the pledge?
Sure.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Dr. Hitchens, are there any changes to tonight's agenda?
Since the meeting was posted, we did upload a couple documents, so they're in there for the public and everyone to see right now under the budget presentation. We have an updated personnel report, which is in your seat, and it will be reflected in the minutes, and there is no closed session.
Excellent. Then I would entertain a motion to approve the agenda with the changes that Dr. Hitchens just mentioned.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Lowe, second by Stoops. All in favor?
Aye.
All right, agenda's approved. Did we get any sheets for public comment tonight since it's all Batavia?
You received one via email.
Thank you. I actually made a note of that and then got all excited because someone was here.
Says well on TV.
Got confused. No one's here. We did have one email that Kathy Scafidi is going to put as a portion of our minutes, correct? And
correct.
All board members have seen the email, so that's just to make sure that anyone who wishes to could get access to it under our public record. I don't see anyone from BASPA. I don't see anyone from the BEA.
No one.
Don't see anyone from the BTO.
We have these wonderful people.
Student ambassadors. So who's doing the consent agenda? Mr.
Brad.
Pierce is not here. All right, Brad. Dr. Newkirk, could you please read the consent agenda? Oh, wait, I have to do my little spiel. I'm all thrown off. No one's here. It's a really short. The consent agenda is a method of streamlining our meetings by taking one vote on a number of routine personnel and business items. Each of the items is detailed in the agenda and has been appropriately posted in the board packet. Are there any items on the consent agenda for removal or for clarification? Right, then.
Yeah, I wanted to pull
you on. Do want to take that off?
Well, just to discuss it.
Oh, sure, that's fine.
Which one?
Four point one two.
We'll remove 4.12 for discussion. Dr. Newkirk, could you please read the rest of the consent agenda?
Sure. Items 4.1 and 4.2 are the approval of the meeting minutes and the closed session minutes for the June 23rd meeting. Item 4.3, I'm going to take a little time here because there are a couple of changes. At your seat, you see a revised personnel report. The two revisions are the inclusion of a resignation, and this would be Bernice Schopp at DHS, and then also, again, a license, this is an employment hire, of Alicia Keller, who will be the social worker at UC's Lawrence Elementary School. Also on that, you'll see the recommendation for approving an administrative contract due to a resignation of Jen Hicks. She will be assuming the assistant principal position at the middle school. Jen has worked very hard, I know, for the past 3 years, honing her skills, and she's going to be a great person for this position, and I'm thrilled to have her as the recommended person for that position. Also on there is the resignation of Dr. Chris Mann. He's been here for 6 years and will be leaving to go to Minnesota.
6 years and only one day, so that's
not that he was counting.
So that's the personnel report. 4.4 are the routine financial items, including the bill sign and journal summary. 4.5 are the treasurer's reports. 4.6 is a donation from the AGS PTO to cover LRC flooring for their remodel. There was one FOIA request this month. We have the destruction of closed session recordings from January 28, 2014, and the time that we're required to keep those has elapsed. 4.9 is the disposal of surplus property. Some of this comes from RMS, and other comes from our summer school outdated materials. 4.10 is some revisions to the Mid-Valley Articles of Agreement, which adjusts our agreement with Mid-Valley. 4.11 is the policy report, which includes a couple of second readings and adoptions of policies that have been previously discussed, and no further feedback or comments has been obtained, so we would ask for approval there. 4.12 has been removed for further discussion, and then that concludes the consent agenda.
Thank you, Dr. Newkirk. Are there any items that anyone would like clarification on or a final call to remove it?
On 4.9, the disposal of surplus property.
Yes.
On like the computer tables, the chairs, is any of that up for sale or is it just being dumped?
No, we go through a process of looking for internal ways to use them, and then we look to donate or sell that property. I don't know the exact plan for the computer tables, Pat.
I don't know actually myself in the moment. I'll have to go back and look and see what condition it's in first.
Okay.
But they look to see what can be sold, and then we do donate a lot of our materials to Scarce, which is in DuPage County. They reuse those materials and then also help support some schools with those materials before our last resort would be pitching those recycling.
Right. I just always want to clarify or know if what's going on with some of the stuff that we might be putting up or getting rid of, if there's any chance of selling it or anything. So, okay, thank you.
Any other questions? Then I would entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda with item 4.12 removed for discussion after.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Dryden, second by Locke. Katie, would you please call the roll?
Blakely.
Yes.
Dryden.
Aye.
Jasper.
Yes.
Locke.
Yes.
Lowe.
Yes.
Stu.
Yes.
Jones.
Yes. Okay, item 4.12 is the HC storm field improvements. Sue, did you just have questions, comments?
Originally, I had an issue with this only because I don't want to say I was confused. I was concerned. I don't know. I had mixed feelings about it. But I did talk to Lisa and Pat, and I'm okay with it now.
Okay.
I have understanding as to why we're doing it, and ultimately it's a safety concern and that's a priority issue. So I don't like the fact that we're kind of band-aiding it, and I think our priority should be more focused at the high school and upgrading the athletic facilities there. But like I said, it is a safety concern there. I actually went out there, walked the fields. And if we're going to have students playing over there on a more long-term basis, and I was told that even with improvements at the high school, we still would be using this. It's definitely a need. So, you know, I had no problem with the bidding, with the company that we, you know, any of that. It was just spending all this money for grass when I'd rather see it put somewhere else. But I don't want any student hurt.
Okay.
Ultimately, that's a problem, you know. So
were you originally looking at this as like it was taking away from any potential work at the high school?
No, because it's a drop in the bucket.
Okay.
Compared to, but I just didn't want us to lose sight of our bigger picture,
gotcha.
I think is what it was.
Okay.
So, but it's definitely a need.
When you say Band-Aid, I'm just...
It's not a Band-Aid.
It's not that it's going to be tore up later on, though, right?
No.
I'm just trying to get your understanding.
No, it's
that it's going to be completed the right way right now.
Right.
Okay.
No, it's not a band. It's a
okay.
Lesser.
And I think we had some questions about the long-term use of this field. And I think on further discussion, one of the things that came out was we're landlocked. So we're going to be using this field regardless of what happens at the high school. And I think that was something that I don't know that we'd put all the pieces together.
Right. And I did talk to Pat and talk to him about seeing about putting some stadium, like some bleachers out there, improving some of the nets after this work is done. You know, it's a 2-year project anyway, so you know, making it a little bit more, let's say, user friendly.
Is this site going to be used for games or just practices?
Both practices and lower level competition will take place there.
So
Lower level competition being like?
Freshmen.
Okay, freshmen.
So if you've got parents and family members or whatever going to watch games and stuff, it'd be nice to have.
And as we discussed, one of the things, this project has come in under budget.
Right.
Or the bidding at least has come in under budget. So we anticipate that if there are no change orders and the project itself goes as expected, there will be some money that we potentially put towards the purchase of some bleachers. We'll look at that in the spring next year.
Is there the opportunity to have shared use of this with like other soccer programs out there, like community-based, Tri-Cities, or the like?
This field, or the pair of fields, will actually now fall under the board policies for athletic field use. So everything that governs the other properties, like the stadium, both in Rotolo and at the high school, this would follow the same policy procedure.
Will there be notice given that these other affiliations that there's additional resources available for them to utilize?
I hadn't thought to put that forward, but it's something we could have done.
Yeah, because if they don't know, I mean, unless a coach drove by and it's like, oh, cool, two new fields. So I think that'd be something that would be smart to do.
Is it mostly going to be for soccer, lacrosse in there or anything, or is it just for soccer?
There are athletic fields that could be striped in a number of different ways.
Okay.
Primarily, we've made the width and length suitable for soccer because we have both spring and fall practice and competition, and it's pretty dominated that it'll be used during those time frames for those that sport.
Okay, and then another question I had, it just seemed like the bids were so far from an extreme of so low to one that was very high. When you saw it, was there stuff in the very high one that they just threw a bunch of things in there, or was it, were they really talking the same language?
I'm not sure why the one bid that came in at almost $200,000, I'm not sure why that was so high. Our estimate for the project was $115,000.
$115,000?
And okay. Obviously we're lower than that. I'm not sure why at the moment. We did conduct a thorough scope review. We also called a number of past clients that have used this particular vendor, and they've all said that they would use them again. So we feel confident that they'll be able to perform for the price they quoted us.
Yeah, I saw the school districts that you had mentioned here, so I have to believe it's very respected of the company. So, okay, I was just wondering on that a bit. So 115 was kind of your target number, but it was a lot lower than that. Okay, that's good.
I think one thing to keep in mind also for when it comes to bids, Pat and I have discussed this before, the variance in pricing a lot of times falls in line with the company's availability to actually do the jobs. So if they have a full scope of work, they may be saying, well, yeah, we take it on for this to move other jobs back. So they may be pricing themselves higher, whereas another company may say, oh, well, we have a nice little gap here to keep our guys working, so we'll come in at a competitive bid like that. And I mean, that's along the scope and scale, I think, from what we've discussed before, for not just field improvements, but any type of service
with
providers.
Any kind of business for itself.
Yeah, if you're really busy,
makes sense.
You might price high to just say, well, if I get it, I get it. But right. If you're not busy, you might be a little bit more competitively advantageous to us to get the bid and they get the work.
And three of them were under the targeted price, so that's a good sign.
Mm-hmm.
So okay.
Yeah, it's not like we have like three coming in
right
high and then one's way under. It's like, oh, wait a minute, you know, what's going on here? So yeah.
Right. Usually those people withdraw their bid.
Yeah, right. They realize they're in a little over their head.
Absolutely. Any other questions?
No, I thank you for
discussing
this. And I do. I had asked Dr. Hitchens this when I talked to her briefly. When this work is being done, is it going to be fenced off so that people don't come in and ruin it or do any kind of, or play on it
when it's dirt
growing and dirt and all that? Are we going to kind of protect it for a while?
I expect there'll be some sort of a rental fence out there. Won't be anything that's necessarily post-driven, but it'll be on a stand of some sort.
Okay.
Well,
I just don't want to spend all this money and it keeps getting damaged or something. We got to start all over, so.
We'll send it to market and make sure that nobody's walking out across the field.
I misunderstood your question. I thought you meant a permanent fence.
And no,
that's actually
no.
Something that Pat had bid out,
no,
and it's pretty expensive.
Mm-hmm. Just till it's done.
We're not able to use it.
Is this something that rugby can use?
It's open grass space at that point, so we can mark and line the field just by anything that we need to.
Okay.
Those guys can play on gravel, though.
I have, but, you know.
Is that your preferred surface?
No, not so much.
All right.
Thanks, Pat.
All right. If anybody, if nobody else has questions, then I would entertain a motion to approve the contract with Continental Construction for the sum of $82,000 to complete the field improvements at HC Storm.
So moved.
Moved by Stoops, second by Locke. Kathy, would you please call the roll?
Yes.
Aye.
Yes.
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 Yes. Next, we're going to be moving on for items for discussion and information. So this is just in the form of some updates for us, sort of our committee work that we're now bringing to the full board. I'm assuming
Pat.
Pat.
Good evening. Evening, everybody.
Hello.
Tonight, I did not prepare a slide presentation similar to what I did last month. There were not quite enough changes to really spend the time going through, but do expect that in August, when we give another update as to how the summer season of construction ended up, that I will have another series of pictures to show you of start and finish and kind of showing where we're at with the projects. In the board packet, I put in three major headings, talked about the completed projects, any projects that are in progress, and also what upcoming projects we have planned still. So for the completed projects, we did get that walkway finally poured. The weather has cooperated. We were able to seal coat the Main Street lot at the high school. We also were able to seal coat this lot this past weekend. The lot over at Hoover Wood. We're still waiting. We're hoping that come Friday and Saturday, we'll be able to seal coat the parking lot over at Rotolo. We have completed the computer lab renovations at Rotolo and at Grace McWayne. And the asbestos abatement has gone well over at Alice Gustafson. Things that are still in progress, the 10-year health life safety projects at the high school, at J.B. Nelson, and at Ellis Gustafson are all going just fine and on schedule. Per the contractor, we're still planning on wrapping those up on July 31st. We really don't have any concerns there at the moment. Spoke with the paving contractor earlier this week, yesterday. I'm hopeful that with the dry weather that we're looking at for this week, hopefully some sunny days, we'll be able to get enough dryness out of that that stone that's there that we'll be able to proof roll on Thursday, and then we'll put down at least the binder course, which is the first layer of asphalt. There's two different layers you put down. The first layer of asphalt will go down on both the of the lots that are over there on Friday. So praying for no rain at the moment, and that we get this little break so that we can get this parking lot in before school starts. Maintenance shop is going well. We're getting ready for the open house that is going to take place next week. We are actually with that. The city's been over there installing the fiber line to the facility so that we have internet and phone there. And actually, we're taking 20 pallets of paper, our first paper delivery tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock. So things are starting to come together, really seeing it take shape over at the maintenance shop. We are finishing up the tile work over at HC Storm. We've completed the last of the demolition that we plan to now that summer school has ended. And we are looking at finishing up the rest of the tile work that's in that area. So really, we've completed the back pod that we originally had started in that I showed you photos of last month. Now we've moved out into the LRC, the old computer lab, and some other area hallway areas that were occupied while summer school is in session. So. Those are the areas that we're wrapping up right now. They have started construction on the new entrance, or the reconfiguration of the entrance over at Ellis Gustafson. So the concrete curbs are being formed up and poured, and they're going to be working on the asphalt this week, so that'll be completed. We did add one change order to that. There was a couple of potholes that were further down in the other two entrances. That we noticed, so we asked them to, while they're out there, handle those as well and make sure that all those entrances were smooth coming in. So that work is getting completed as we speak. Talked about the seal coating. The lunchroom tables are, they have been demolished over at Louise White, and I expect delivery of the new ones to come in tomorrow. So those will be installed and complete as of the end of the day tomorrow. So that's going to be done on time. And then the LRC renovations, we had a little bit of a downtime as we've waited for some stuff to be delivered, but now the glass partitions that go into some of those back areas, those kind of pods that we were creating for pullout spaces and meeting rooms, those glass walls are going to be installed. We've got the carpet in, so once the glass is installed, we'll finish up the carpet work. And then all of the casework and other furniture that the PTO purchased will be delivered and installed. So that should wrap up here in the next 30 days. And then, as we said last month, we're still waiting on work to really commence with the boiler project. We're really targeting that as soon as the open house at Rotolo is completed, then we will actually start to work on the piping over there, because we need to have a couple of down days because of the piping configuration, where we would actually turn off the chillers, break into that piping configuration, and redo it as part of the scope, and then we can isolate that section, turn the chillers back on, and continue our work for the next couple of months, and have those boilers up and running for October 1st. I've seen all the submittals going through the engineer, and we've reviewed those as well. So things are getting ordered and moving right along with that. And then obviously with approval tonight of the HC Storm fields, I will get a hold of the contractor. We've already submitted for the Kane DuPage water permit with the City of Batavia. We're also preparing the permit information for the ROE. So we'll get all those submitted and look to start. I believe the bid packet called for a August 1st start date. And I think we also put in there something to say that we wanted them done by the 19th with mass movement of the earth, so that we didn't have machines out there when kids were showing up on the first day, naturally. So those are my updates. Any questions for?
The only thing is, on these room designs, you're taking out the computer labs. Mm-hmm. Now, are you just keeping the room itself as a big shell for a classroom, or are you dividing it, or what's going to happen in those rooms now? I mean, what are they set up for?
It varies. It depends on how the principal of the buildings decided to repurpose the use of the space.
Okay.
So, for example, at Rotolo, the computer lab there is being converted into a classroom space. So it actually got new lighting in there. It's much brighter than it was. All new tile work where there was carpet. It mirrors the standards for what our typical classrooms look like. Other rooms we're moving the collaboration stations into, and those will be used in a different manner. Some of them are more soft spaces, so it varies, and we're tailoring what work we're doing in there to accommodate what the goals of the principal were for that building.
Okay. Any other questions? Great, thanks for the update, Pat.
Thank you.
Moving on to routine financial updates, Dr. Mann.
Just going to let Dr. Newkirk do this, just kidding. I've got about five things to update on. First, cash flow. As I said, back in June, we got the first of the large property tax distributions at the end of June, so we've now invested funds all the way out through February. We've invested about $22.281 million, and with the interest that we get back, we'll get $22.286. We get about $5,500 of interest for all of that. That's where the rates are currently at. So it's a lot of work to get a little bit of interest, but we'll take everything, and we will keep maximizing that whenever we can. When September's, we made a few investments through July and August that will mature to, you know, help fund payrolls and bills payable in these months. And then the September taxes will fund most of what we do in September, October, and November. And then these taxes that we just invested now start hitting again, maturing in December, January, and February. Your low cash point will again be in the March-April timeframe of next year. FY15 year-end estimates. In the budget summary that is part of the later discussion, you'll recall that we predicted a surplus of a little over $900,000, between $900,000 to $1 million when we adopted the budget last year.
As we reported to you in February, we actually saw revenues really exceed what we had budgeted in the area of the special ed reimbursements between the state and federal, along with property tax collections were at 99.8% rather than 99.5%. So those things combining, we did have a couple of our expense accounts that exceeded budgets, but I really believe that the year-end estimates will end somewhere between $1.5 to $2 million is where the surplus for FY15 will likely be. That has to do with how much of the property taxes will the auditors move back or move forward on the June 30th statements. If you recall, I said we collected about 50.8% by the end of June 30th, which is an anomaly. We never collect more than 50%. So I don't know if the auditors will say we have to account for all of them, which is a lot more taxes than we would have budgeted for, or if they are going to move that 0.8% forward into next year. So that's a question going forward. But it's indeed and definitely a surplus that was higher than what we budgeted for last year. State budget I have in there. This happened almost right after we had the meeting last month. But Governor Rauner did sign into effect the appropriations for K-12 education. However, we have not gotten our final allocations. The State Board of Education has not yet given us back the actual numbers for what we'll see for general state aid or our special ed reimbursements or any of that. So we're still working off of estimates for state revenues, but generally by the end of July or the middle of August, most of those should start to happen now that a budget is in place for at least K-12 education. Last two things have to deal with insurance. This is the first year that we are subject to all of the provisions of the Affordable Care Act. So the business office, and especially Mrs. Giannata, the Assistant Director of Finance, has been working quite diligently over the past 3 months to identify the other employees that we need to offer coverage to. Obviously, all of our full-time employees and most of our part-time employees are offered some type of insurance, but when it comes to long-term subs or some people that may be substitutes and also do coaching for us, there's been a lot of calculations to figure out if they get to enough hours to where we had to offer them some type of coverage. And I believe you said we had eight people that we had to extend the high deductible plan that we approved back in May. They have till pretty much the end of this month to decide if they're going to accept that or not, so there will be updates forthcoming if anyone decided to add on to our plan. But because we were able to identify, we are not subject to any penalties, we have offered affordable coverage under the Act. The last piece here is the self-insurance fund. We've just completed year one. And though we did just have to increase premiums by 11.5%, you know, as trend went up, we did end June 30th with a balance of $1,054,000 in the account. So some of that is still owed. Obviously, when people went to the doctor in June, we still have to pay those bills. But that is money that this district has been able to retain and not send off to an insurance company. So that will help, hopefully, as trend goes forward, that will help lower premiums, and you can use that to offset a really big year in the future. So it did work to keep the money here in the district and build up the type of reserve that you were hoping for. So happy to answer any questions over any of the random areas. I was going to touch on the federal budget here, but there, I know some parts of the Elementary, Secondary, and Education Act have been passed by the feds, but I don't believe it's full law yet, and I believe it's the name will be changing to the Every Child Achieves Act is the latest phrase, so No Child Left Behind is going to go away. So yeah, a new phrase for it, but the federal, we have gotten all of our federal entitlements. They just may change the requirements that go along with them.
Are there any big changes in our transportation fund that should be noted?
Big changes in the transportation fund would be primarily, well, we aren't quite to the budget
yet. Yeah,
I'm sorry.
Can we knock that out?
We'll get there then. My apologies.
Any questions just on those updates? Because we will dig deep into your packet when we get there. So, hold your excitement and your questions. All right, then we'll move on to our action items. Our first action item is the food service change at Batavia High School, 6.1.
I'm actually going to ask Mrs. Giannata to come up to the microphone.
All right. Hello, everyone.
Hi.
So, as you recall from the May board meeting, Quest, representative from Quest, Nick, was here and gave a presentation about the high school and proposed changes about taking the high school off the National School Lunch Program. So, just to kind of refresh your memory, all eight of our schools are currently on the National School Lunch Program, and the program is available to all public and private schools who operate a nonprofit program offering lunches that meet federal requirements to all of our children. And so if we meet those requirements, we receive federal reimbursements. And if you recall, last July, July 1st, there were stricter guidelines imposed upon the nutrition programs. So there were significant changes that we had to follow with our menu offerings and what we're allowed to sell in schools. It affected not only just our reimbursable meals, but any food that we can sell in schools, whether it's a la carte items, vending machines, fundraising, all that kind of stuff. And so ever since then, our food service sales have been declining in all of our schools, which is largely due to those new requirements. One interesting tidbit I heard today was that there's 1 million less kids eating per day since those new guidelines went into place, which I thought was interesting. So
not
here
in Batavia.
You know, yes, we don't have 1 million kids. So we think that if the high school were to come off the National School Lunch Program, we think sales would increase because kids would have more options and more variety of food to choose from. So just to recap what we heard in May, those changes would be with regards to the reimbursable meal, which would no longer be called a reimbursable meal, but the protein in that meal, like the meat that we're serving, could be anywhere from 1/2 ounce to 1.5 ounces bigger. And then right now we can only serve whole grains, but then we could also incorporate white grains as well. We'd still be offering the other components of the meal, like a vegetable, fruit, and milk and water, so that would remain unchanged. If you recall, we were shown pictures about the portion sizes, and we saw that the portion sizes would be bigger under this this new option. And then the other food items that we can sell, all of our a la carte items, like the individual things that kids purchase, we wouldn't be as restricted. So, I mean, we would work with Quest and we could, you know, offer a much wider variety of items. Things like hummus, I mean, weren't allowed before, I mean, which is pretty healthy. Different kinds of chips, things like that, in addition to increased portion sizes. So, we did some site visits. Chris, myself, and Dave Andrews, and visited a couple high schools who operate in this new manner, which is not part of the National School Lunch Program. And in talking to students and observing them, we found that kids were really happy and satisfied with the new options that they have and just kind of the freedom to purchase more things. And if you recall from Quest's presentation, they touched on like the different concepts that they would have. One was like a deli concept, or it'd be like a build-to-order station. One could be like a Chipotle kind of idea where kids can create their own dish similar to that. And then they would have different rotating stations as well. We've been told that kitchen at the high school is very conducive to this type of setup because we have different serving lines. Kids can kind of come and go, and it's easier for them to get in different lines. And so, you know, timing wouldn't be an issue. Kids would have time to go through various lines. So we have the right facilities in place for this already. We would still provide free and reduced lunches under this new structure. And the pricing, the meal pricing, we'll get to the numbers, but our financial projections are based on a meal price of $2.80, which is an increase of 12 cents, but that's what we would have had to increase regardless of what we do, because we already increased meal prices at all of our other schools by 12 cents. So keep that in mind. And our food service provider, Quest, they currently operate several high schools who are not part of the National School Lunch Program, so they're very experienced in this, and our food service director has experience in this as well, so we would expect a smooth transition. So whoever is navigating, would you mind pulling up the historical, yes, that one. Wonderful.
My head's loaded, so another shot.
Somebody call Tom.
So there's a lot of numbers on here, but the top part of it is a summary, and then...
Historical.
West historical.
The bottom part is just the supporting data, so the top numbers shows you, this is just at the high school, you can see the decline in sales from 13-14 to 14-15. That's how long we've been with Quest. We don't have, you know, historical data going back further than that. But you can see in paid lunches over the past year, it's down 8%. In a la carte sales, it's down 22%, so an average of 18% decline just over the past year. And then below that is just all the supporting data. Would you mind pulling up the that one. So this is the financial projections that we put together with the help of Quest. The first two columns are if the high school were to stay on the National School Lunch Program. What's highlighted in yellow is what our estimated revenue would be, just at the high school alone. So in the first column, that's based on student sales with the new lunch price of $2.80. And it's based on just keeping sales, if sales were to remain flat from last year, so in other words, if they did not decline any further, if the levels were consistent from last year. Same with a la carte sales as well. And then that shows the reimbursements that we receive. We subtract out what we actually pay to Quest, that's the program billing line. So in the first column, if levels were to remain consistent, we would be receiving $58,000. The second column, that's probably what would be more likely to occur. That reflects a decrease in paid sales of 15%. Based on the fact that over the past year our sales went down 18% on average, we think 15% is pretty reasonable that sales would decline. So in that scenario, our anticipated return is $50,000. And if you go over to the third column, so this third column is if the high school were to come off the National School Lunch Program, the student sales and a la carte sales, those are calculated based on a formula, and it's basically the student enrollment times the number of service days times our per capita, which we used $1.40, and then times the percent of sales as meals. And our per capita, like I said, we used $1.40. If you scroll down a little bit, you can see that. But that is actually pretty conservative. Based on other districts who are similar to the high school with student population and our free and reduced numbers, other districts see a per capita of about $1.65 to $1.70. And what the per capita is, that's what we expect each student to spend per day. So in other words, each student at the high school is spending $1.40 per day on average, which is conservative, like I said. So based on all of that, in this third scenario, our estimated revenue is $57,000. It would be higher than what we anticipate, which is the second column. So I guess you're comparing the second column to the third column. What else? The reimbursement rates that
I understand. First column is the projection if we don't move off the nutritional program.
Yeah, and sales were to remain.
The third column is if we do.
Correct.
These are the projections?
Correct.
Mr. Dryden, the first column is if somehow sales are able to remain flat despite the trend in the past two or three years of seeing sales decline. So the second column is really what we believe would happen for next year. Mm-hmm. We think that sales would continue to decline by some other percentage.
Remind me why we're interested in that.
It mostly opens up the offerings that students can eat. They have bigger variety, and One thing to keep in mind is this is just first year's projections. We didn't project it out any further, but as time goes on, we expect...
Why do I care about the numbers? What do these numbers have to do with anything?
It basically just supports our rationale that we believe this is the right choice for the high school.
We don't believe the numbers are going to hurt the recommendation, is what this supports. There's not a real financial decision to do this, because we believe it's essentially break-even. You know, $7,000 in our budget is not that much.
If that's what we believe, then let's talk about this in a non-financial sense.
Makes sense.
Because I'm not quite sure why I need to be interested in how many meals we sell or what the revenue from that is. Because I don't normally think of myself in an organization that cares a lot about sales. I could be misunderstanding something.
Although I think one of the concerns was we didn't want to move to that and then have a financial loss for the district, because that would be highly unpopular and not a particularly responsible fiscal choice. So I think that's kind of the first concern is, do we think we're going to make a mistake financially?
Okay.
And we've discussed this before in Finance Committee, which I think I'm the only person left who actually was on Finance Committee. And there was just a great desire.
Literally looked right at me.
Did we talk about this when you, we started talking about this like 3 years ago.
The food is better. It's better food.
We started talking about it.
I think that's a big part of it, is that it's better food for the kids. It's not little portions of just fruits and vegetables.
Can I suggest something absolutely crazy then?
Sure.
As we move forward on this stuff, if we're going to serve food at the high school, I think that the middle school, that as we move forward in terms of menu negotiations, et cetera, that we would include representatives from the student body on that committee and have real choices. And here's why. Because the entire rationale, everything that I've heard, is we're talking about we want better choices for the kids. We want kids to be piling down on this stuff. And I think if they had some input in terms of what was being sold, we would be where we wanted to be.
I think that was suggested, wasn't it?
Yeah, in fact, we met, you may have heard Quest has a new food service director, and we had the opportunity to meet with him. And that is one of the ideas that he had, is to have more student involvement in menu planning. He suggested things like cooking classes or working with a foods class at the high school and coming up with a food service committee.
Is this something the student council couldn't be involved with, other than just planning dances? Is this the kind of thing that they could maybe, go, wow, this is we're involved with this?
I think there's lots of opportunities.
Okay. And I don't mean to bog this process down. I'm just trying to figure out where we're going with this. Mm-hmm. We all like more choice.
Yeah.
Right. Well, I think that's also what our student ambassadors are for, and maybe that's something we could do. Is ask them. We've asked them to do things, if that's something we want to do in the committee.
But I love the idea, again, of integrating this just into normal student life.
Well, aside from that, we have to think that, they're our sales base, so we should be responding to the trends that they're going to respond to, whether it's, beverage choice and keeping it reasonable, of course, but or food selection, if something, and I'm sure it's an ongoing process as well with Quest. They're going to see like, oh, this station's not as successful as it could be. We have the facilities to be able to kind of restart, revamp, go in a different direction that fits within their providings as well.
Yeah, in fact, they've suggested, getting together really as much or as little as we want to, but at least after each semester and sitting down and looking at the sales and the menu choices, and at that point, making changes to the menu items and, working with what the kids want to eat. And, we
Will
really have a lot of say in that.
Sorry. Will this be communicated to the kids that there's going to be these new menu options and this new, these new meal plans and this fun new food and more food?
They'll definitely communicate it, put up, promotional posters. We'll send out information.
Because I figured most are just going to come in assuming it's the same. If we don't communicate that there's a change.
Yeah, in the past, they've done like sampling where they like sample food, so I imagine they'll do, you know, things like that.
Yeah, they've done things like that in the past.
It would seem to me that Quest has a vested interest to have maximize their sales, so they're going to figure out what the kids like. It's up to us to set the parameters which they can work under, so it seems like we're on the right track. I don't necessarily think that we need to...
It's a work in progress.
Yeah.
So just a point of information, and maybe I just don't, as I understand the contract, the school, we're not on the hook if Quest doesn't meet some threshold of sales.
Not at all.
We're not, the district isn't...
No.
Liable if they don't meet a certain number, don't meet a certain...
Other than the fact our budget could fall.
What those financial, what that spreadsheet showed was, to do this, we're giving up the right to get any federal reimbursement for the meals. When we're on the program, everything we sell, we get reimbursed at some level from the federal government. We're going to give up, you know, the right to claim those reimbursements in addition for some percentage of the sales, 10% is in this contract,
right,
of what Quest can do.
Right.
That's the financial stake in the game. That's the only chance that we could be hurt by this is if their sales don't get to a point where we at least offset the federal reimbursements.
Right. So that puts us in a situation where we have a vested interest in selling more chocolate pudding or hummus or whatever else.
Correct.
Which is an interesting position to be in.
So we were more restricted by the federal government.
Oh, yeah.
And now we can sell pretty much anything.
Well, I mean, there's a reasonable responsibility,
right,
that we're going to get socially here as well.
I'm just saying, I'm just going to the other way.
You can sell anything
and not worry about what the federal government says.
Mm-hmm.
My concern, John, is I sit down in the monthly meeting, I'm concerned about how much stuff we sold, which isn't really kind of what I thought I was signing up for. You'll have to forgive me. You know, selling stuff is one thing. Managing a social institution is another thing.
Well, I don't personally like the part of being under the thumb of the federal government on some things, so I'm more or less...
Eat your vegetables. I know it's onerous.
I'm more or less just going with, let's just sell stuff and whatever happens, happens. But I was just telling Tina, I looked at the half a pint of milk, and I had to chuckle because when I went to school...
You're going to put this on camera.
White milk was 3 cents, and chocolate milk was 4 cents, and now it's 55 cents. So there's a big difference.
It was probably whole milk back then, wasn't it?
And it was good milk. But I'm just saying, I'm fine with just going this route. See what happens.
Speaking of milk, can you explain this special milk?
So that since we wouldn't, if the high school were to come off the National School Lunch Program, we would be able to enroll in the special milk program, which is it's another federal reimbursement program. So the revenue isn't as much as, you know, we're used to getting, but we anticipate to get $10,000 through that program just by signing up for it and submitting claims. Like,
so that's just the name of the
lunch
program.
You can get reimbursed
for
breakfast.
It's not like fortified or like, you know.
It's the special milk program.
Okay.
It's like buying recycled paper that costs.
Special X-Men. One question I have is, and this might just be more socially compassed, why aren't we selling coffee?
You know, that has come up before, that question. It's something we can definitely look into if that's what the kids want. I know high school is set up for it, like logistically.
Really.
The high school is set up for it.
Logistically, I mean, there would be room for it.
No, look here.
One of the side businesses we went to did sell coffee and coffee drinks, and they were fairly popular. But again, it's more of a social and, you know, more of a policy type discussion of...
Mm-hmm. Well, that Joanne's
thought. That was something that we kind of talked about is, I don't know if we're going to...
Yes, Joanne wants to sell coffee.
Create a policy, but
I think a lot of our students like coffee.
There might be a vested interest in, as a board, us having at least a philosophy about this moving forward, since we're removing some external parameters, so that we're all kind of in agreement. Like, do we want to be a school district that sells coffee, or do we not? You know what I mean?
You can get into any of those discussions. I mean, I don't like Pop-Tarts being on the list either. So, you know, but that's just me.
They're trying to think some general. Philosophical parameters,
I would agree, because, I mean, I don't, to me, I see it as, well, kids are going to McDonald's or limestone or Dunkin' Donuts before school anyways, you know, and, but again, I'm like, I don't want to be in the position of trying to, you know, capture a clientele per se, you know, and being in the business of sales, like John said. I mean, I just want to be able to, if that's a demand or something that the students are, you know, asking to respond to, because they can only really get it when, before they come to school. It's not like, hey, teach, I'm going to Starbucks, you know, making a run, you know.
Does anybody want anything?
Yeah, anyone want anything? So.
I'm simply throwing out as an objection that our relationship to the students fundamentally changes once we go down this road. Now, this is a customer base, as opposed to a student body that we're charged to educate. And it's, it, you know, I don't.
But we're in charge of a food program either way. So, right. So we have to provide a food program. So
yes.
We're going to try to provide a food program that they would at least enjoy. Right now, they're not really enjoying it and still healthy.
The relationship changes, though, in that now we have a vested interest for the kids to buy more stuff.
Well, we've always had a vested interest.
I don't know.
We still have a contract.
This contract is based, though, on, so I'm going to go back to my original question, and maybe I misunderstood the contract. I understand this contract, we are reimbursed based on a percentage of sales. Is that correct?
We keep all the sales and we reimburse them, do we not?
They get a commission based on it.
It reverses that. They're now causing the sales and they're giving us a piece of it. Whereas in our other schools, we're taking all the sales and paying them for every meal that goes out the door.
Got you.
We're still, either program we're making, we're profiting.
Right.
So it doesn't, it's part of having to provide lunch. We have to provide lunch.
And there is a vested interest even now in us selling more lunches.
And we're profiting by quantity either way.
Correct. Mm-hmm. Correct.
So,
but my contention is we're serving voodoo nutrition to our students under the federal lunch program.
So my understanding is the way that we're changing that relationship, as to borrow John's phrase, is we are determining what can be sold as opposed to the federal government telling us what we can sell.
That's the difference.
So really, that's
in the anticipation that we'll sell more.
No, it's
just
the
anticipation that we're providing a truly better nutrition. Right now, you cannot serve hummus and carrots in our lunch room. And I defy anyone to tell me that's not a healthier choice than a low-fat cheese pizza on a cardboard crust.
But it's also, the numbers that were presented to us were not an increase. They were numbers that we've seen over the last couple years, am I correct?
Right, yeah, that doesn't.
So, I mean, you didn't increase those numbers because you thought the kids are going to go, you know, hog wild over all this food. It was basically what we've been seeing.
Correct.
So, we're not really looking, I don't believe this program is meant for us to profit. We're just trying to create, we have to provide food, and we're trying to provide food that the kids are going to like.
Right.
And the current model is showing that it's diminishing in interest. With you know, historical year-over-year data that we've been seeing on being under the federal program and what Quest has to provide proportionally and as sides and such, the student body has already reacted to us by saying, pass.
Right.
Yeah.
You know? I find it morally repugnant that we are throwing milk and fruits and vegetables away because we cannot be reimbursed if we do not put those things on the student's
check.
We're not at all changing the relationship. All we're doing is having the exact same relationship, providing lunch, getting certain revenues from those lunches, but now providing them in a realistic way with some very healthy standards that we're to decide instead of the federal government deciding.
But I also want to talk about, and I know, like John, you had mentioned that this is a weird topic to be discussing, but in the past, we have had complaints about the types of food that we are serving. That's something that I think our community has brought to us on more than one occasion. We don't like, the kids don't like food, the kids don't like the lunches, there's not enough food, why aren't they getting this? So this is actually, we are answering not only to our students, but to our community. This has been an issue before. So it seems silly, but it's a topic.
So the question that I have is, since we are going from a policy where the government is setting all of our standards, what standards do we have in place as a district that keeps us from making it a revenue stream and keeping some type of handle on some type of nutritional guideline that we want to keep?
Well, that's Quest.
Quest,
we've worked with Quest. They've worked in our
that's
district.
That's actually why we chose them initially.
That's their job. Their job is to provide nutrition. They're not going to just come in and open a McDonald's. So.
Well, but their goal is to sell as many meals as possible. Do we not want to have some type of parameter in place so that we can go, if we feel like they're pushing meals in order to make the most profit, so that we can step in and say, you know what, we have this guideline in place, we would like you to meet these parameters.
Well, and that's where they're showing us the menus.
I don't understand, like, if all of a sudden we have this huge bump, and our kids really like this food, and they're excited about it, I don't understand what the
hell is. But like Chris was saying, if all of a sudden we're serving deep dish pizza, we've completely...
Oh, but they've given us the menu, we...
Right, that's what I'm saying, so...
But we've already said that, you know, for some reason the kids don't like this station, we're gonna swap it out.
Well, we're kind of just saying that, as Quest said that for sure.
I think we have a wellness policy.
You said you were gonna be communicating with them on a regular basis.
I mean, that's what I'm asking, what do we have in writing that actually...
We have a wellness policy, that's what we're talking about, do we need to just revisit it?
Policy 6:50 is school wellness, there's a whole section on nutrition guidelines for foods available in schools during the school day.
And so that was the question, we might just need to revisit that to ensure that it encompasses us moving forward into this.
Then I'm gonna ask that, you know, I am totally down with approving this, but I think that that is something that we would at least wanna review moving forward, so that we can say, hey, we've thought about this, and then if we run into problems, or if we decide that we wanna change it immediately, we at least know where we're starting from. And we've discussed it.
And I think one thing that's kinda getting lost in the ether here is, we can always go back on the school lunch program at any time that we want to. There's no penalty, you know, I mean, if this program doesn't work, or we're getting like even more blowback from our students for offering them more selection, larger portions.
Better food.
Better food.
Or we have a concern that we've lost our way.
Our direction on it, I mean...
Well, I think also, you did site visits to schools where this is, and it was with Quest, right?
Correct, yeah.
So you saw what they were offering students.
We did, we were at, Kathy and I and Steve were at a school that served...
This style.
So it wasn't some Wild West free-for-all.
It was great.
I don't think there's gonna be any concern that the kids are gonna buy the food more than they were before.
So I think, moving forward, we can look at our policy to ensure that as board we're comfortable with what those standards are, and then I think we need to be handing that, like, once we've set that policy, then we need to be handing that next step off to someone at the high school, someone in the district office, whoever we deem appropriate to be reporting back to us maybe annually, like, here are the types of, you know, here are the menus, they're still consistent with what you're doing, and so that we can, again, hold someone accountable that these are the direction we gave you.
We have done that. I don't want it to seem like we have not done that before. We have a good relationship with Quest, I think that...
But we didn't have any control over menu before, so now we can, again, we can ask for annual reporting.
Mm-hmm. And by we, it's not us. This is dance floor stuff.
Yeah, exactly. We are really on the dance floor right now.
Let's let the people we pay to do their jobs do their jobs.
Which is why I think we should review the policy so that we're not every month going, hey, they're going to put a new station and let's talk about it.
Right.
We shouldn't have to do that.
But I don't think we're just...
Well, right.
Because we hired a company that knows what to do.
Yeah, and I don't think we're giving them carte blanche to be like, oh, we're offering, you know, like, you know, pasta bowls and sandwich stations, and then next month they're going to be like, all right, it's fried nachos and, you know, hoagies all day or anything like that. So
the next chance we'd really have to review this policy is very timely, because it would be the end of August meeting, correct, that we could ensure that our wellness policy encompasses any of our concerns regarding changing our lunch program.
So you're saying, do you believe our wellness policy doesn't align with this? Because I believe it does.
I believe it does.
I have not spent a whole lot of time, so that's what I'm saying. We can read it and ensure that it's encompassing.
Correct? I mean, isn't this...
Yeah, but I wasn't looking at it in terms of, like, our lunch is going to fall under that. So just a question, we can review it.
The first arrow that you see there would apply to foods that are not reimbursed. The second arrow specifically talks to the reimbursable school meals. So this says that we will restrict the sale of foods of minimal nutritional value as defined by the U.S. Department of Agriculture.
Right.
Which probably alleviates a lot of your concerns about the types of food that we will be offering. But of course, the administration can put this policy up for discussion.
Right. And my concern is, like, what about some of the stuff that they can't serve now under the federal school lunch program? Is that under the USDA policy, or is that under a different...
That's under the National School Lunch Program regulations, not
which
necessarily...
Which is different than the USDA. Yes. Okay, so, and again, that's where I'm saying we can talk about it. I don't see it being lengthy, but just ask those questions rather than beat a dead horse tonight, so that we're not trying to read it, assess it, and analyze it tonight. We can just spend a few minutes next meeting, and then we'll move forward.
So So what I'm hearing is that we're going to add the policy to the next board agenda, not the August 11th, but the later one in August.
The review.
Just review it, give you guys a chance to read it, bring any suggestions, and then you're going to hand the rest over to...
Absolutely.
Staff.
After we adopt it. After we... Does anyone have any further questions about this change? Yes, no?
Nope.
All right, then I would entertain a motion to remove Batavia High School from the National School Lunch Program and enter into a separate one-year agreement with Quest.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Gaspar, second by Stoops. Kathy, would you please call the roll?
Ridley?
Yes.
Ryden?
No.
Gaspar?
Yes.
Locke?
Yes.
Lowe?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Excellent. Been that one for a long time. Next, we're going to move on to Dr. Mann and talk about the 2015-16 tentative budget.
Good evening, everyone. In previous years, we've set aside a night just to go into kind of workshop discussions on this. Tonight, because of the timing of when the board wanted to do their public hearing, we needed to do this tonight during the meeting. So there will be action at the end of this where you will be asked to officially put the budget on public display and set the date and time of your public hearing for your second meeting in August. We'll get to that after we go through all these wonderful numbers. So there were two documents that made it their way into board docs. There's this presentation. There was a PDF of the budget summary document that we've used for a few years. I also did complete this afternoon getting everything into the detailed state budget form, and I have hard copies here. But if any of you would like a hard copy of the wonderfully easy-to-read state forms that they put numbers on. But that will also be put on the website tomorrow after this meeting. So a quick overview. I'm going to give you a quick update on the things that we still do not know, the things that are still yet to be finalized. Then we will go through revenue budgets, both local, state, and federal, and then the expenditure budgets, looking at the functions, looking specifically at personnel costs, buildings and departments, and then some of our non-operating expenses that are built in here. So kicking off with the budget assumptions, these are the things that we don't yet know. Obviously, I know Batavia Township did publish their assessments, and it looked like most property got a reassessment of 3.25% upwards. That was much higher than we were predicting, but there were many exceptions to that rule. But we don't know the final assessments. People can still go through the appeal process. We also do not know the final new construction for this year of 2015 that will impact your first tax collection in next year. These will not even be known when you adopt the final budget, so you'll have to have some assumptions here. Final student fee revenue, we don't start collecting student fees until the beginning of August. So obviously we're using assumptions based on last year's data. We've made some minor adjustments for enrollment. We also made some adjustments for the fact that the elementary Chromebooks and devices are added to the fees now as well. Final state revenue allocations, we talked about that in the other update, but we know the overall state budget that they've passed, but we don't know how that's going to break down into every district's individual allocation. So in most cases where that is unknown, we're using last year's figures because we were told that they were budgeted at a stable level. Late summer hires, obviously personnel and benefits will continue to change all the way through the start of the school year, possibly even after, as last minute hires are made over the summer or as new student needs present the need to change or modify your staffing levels. And then always at some point in the summer, we have our initial federal grant allocations, but there are always those districts that somehow don't spend their grants, and so there's normally some type of carryover or extra funds that become available. That hopefully we will know about by the time we get to final adoption in September. Questions over those? Otherwise, we're rolling right into what we have for revenue. All right, if we can go to the revenue summary page. Here you see this breaks out the revenue by the big categories that we put into our summary documents. Obviously, property taxes is by far our largest operating revenue, making up over 80%. Again, that's been a very stable revenue source for us. So despite the lag in the state economy and the state budget woes, property taxes, because they go directly from our community to the county and then back to us, it's been a very stable and consistent revenue source for us. Other local revenue consists of student fees or any revenue from food service sales, participation, corporate personal property replacement tax. The other local, the big decrease in that is there was a one-time, when the TIF 2 expired down in Aurora, they had fund balance that they had to distribute out to us. So it was a loss of that. We also no longer get the insurance rebate now that we are self-insured. So that explains the losses there. General state aid, I'll talk about on a previous slide. Other state gets into all of the other categoricals. And then you can see our federal grants. So because of the loss of those one-time revenues and the loss of the general state aid, now that we're back onto a different formula, we do actually predict that our revenues will slightly go down over what they were last year. But like I told you, as we saw happen throughout the year, our revenues greatly increased last year to, you know, to cover. So we are still predicting a surplus budget for this year. Property tax revenues. You can scroll down. The assumptions that we have, last year was a 1.5 CPI. We already know it's going to be a 0.8 CPI for the 2015 levy. We have assumed that the board would take the full CPI. It is less than 1%, but that's obviously something you finalize in the November and December timeframe when you adopt the levy. We have estimated $5 million for to new construction for 2015, and we've still got a negative property growth predicted. That doesn't really impact the amount of taxes we collect. It impacts the tax rate. So it's more of a function on how it's going to be divided out amongst the community, but it's still an assumption. We have only estimated a tax collection rate of 99.5. For the past few years, we've exceeded that. It's been 99.7 or 99.8. So that would be, I think we estimated around $300,000 of additional revenue if they continue to keep the collection rate high. But you can see how it plays out into the individual funds. Between education and special education, those are both aggregated into Fund 10 when you look at our budget. The only non-operating taxes that we collect are for our debt service in bonds and interest on that final line there. We no longer levy for working cash or for tort immunity. Questions on tax revenues? All right. I didn't have a slide for all of the other local revenues because there's just so many accounts to try to take in. But as I said, other local revenues start with interest income, which for our operating budget is, even though we should have a fund balance of just about $20 million at year end, our interest income is $15,750 on that $20 million. Like I said, student fees, registration fees, participation fees, and then any lunch sales or breakfast sales. Also, rentals from using our facilities. So when people rent the Batavia Fine Arts Center or any of our other gyms for those things, that all goes into other local revenue. State revenues, here's this page. The biggest difference in our state revenues is general state aid. Some of you may recall last year we saw about a $300,000 increase in general state aid. That was because our EAV had declined enough to where we fell into the lowest level of state funding. I call it the lowest, but it's actually where you get the most state revenue. It was called the foundation level. But then this year, the EAV from the TIF, from the Aurora Outlet Mall and that industrial area has re-hit this formula, so now we're back into the middle level. So that actually drops us back down to where we had been for quite a few years at the 2.7. We are still prorating this at 89% is the number we have. The state approved a budget of 92, which would be about another $90,000 for us in that ballpark. But until the state actually gives us and starts sending money and last year we were at 89, and then they changed things in February, and then we were at 87. So we've left it at 89%. So you know there could be additional revenues coming for general state aid if they fund it to everything that they have appropriated. The other state grants, on the left here you can see what we call general revenues, even though they're, some of them are grants. So bilingual education, about 81,000. The vocational, career and technical educational improvement, I think it is, about 70,000. We get about 40 back in driver's education, just under that. And then the state free lunch of $6,000. Transportation reimbursement. Just today, Mr. Mark Anderson, who handles a lot of our day-to-day transportation, he and I submitted the transportation claim for last year. And our regular claim came to $1.2 million, and special education was about $1.75 million, which is much higher than we have in here. However, last year, you know, we only got about $614,000 in regular. So we knew we could anticipate some increase because we had increased costs, but that is one of the heaviest areas that the state will prorate. So I told Dr. Hitchens I was still recommending that even though we submitted a claim for almost $3 million, I would recommend not really changing these figures until the state actually starts sending allocations out. So this combined is 2.47, so it's about 16% less than, if I did that quick math right, but. Yeah, about $500,000 less than what your claim actually submitted for. The other side is all of the special education revenues, which we think of as the mandated categoricals, if you will. Transportation is often put into that category too, but personnel was the only one that we really increased over last year because we, working with Mrs. Blasey, our Director of Student Services, we've actually identified more people that we are eligible to claim. Some of the people that do consultant work for us can be claimed under this. So we felt comfortable increasing this by a marginal amount. I think it was only about $50,000 is all we increased it by, but extraordinary services and private facility, we kept stable until we see claims come back. However, new to us this year, and a change from May, is we've been able to actually claim reimbursement for orphanage costs for special needs children. So we've added about $111,000 of orphanage reimbursement along with about $27,000 of special education summer school. I got many raised eyebrows on that.
What is orphanage?
It is when we have residential placements that are wards of the state. And there is a facility in Aurora that is within our boundary that we have finally just worked out, you know, all the claim procedures, and so now we are claiming these students, and our submittal to the state was $111,308.
Do we also have students from Moosart, and do they qualify?
No.
Again, this is special education, so it's wards of the state that are placed at a residential facility. So, yes, Moosart, we are responsible for providing some light services through our federal grants to some Moosart students if they are within grade levels that get services, I believe. Dr. Newkirk is our Title I grant expert, so he could fill you in on all of the Moosart requirements here.
Fascinating.
So, anything else on the state revenues? All right, federal revenues. You can see when I typed this, I wasn't quite sure what the new name of NCLB was going to be, so I did put that in quotes. But now the ECA requirements, I'm not sure. But these are the numbers that we have been allocated initially from the federal government. Again, there could be some carryover from our district's grants last year, and oftentimes they release additional money, you know, either late summer or early fall that we can work into our grants. Individual with Disabilities Act, or IDEA. Flow-through is obviously the largest one. The large portion of that goes to offset tuition at our Mid-Valley Co-op, about $815,000 of that grant. We do get a small reimbursement for preschool. And then room and board is one of those revenues, along with the Medicaid revenue you'll see at the bottom, that our Student Services Department has just done a fabulous job of increasing their reporting abilities. So last year we budgeted about $60,000 for IDEA room and board, and we received $315,000. So They've done an outstanding job of improving their processes there. And the same thing on Medicaid. We used to budget about $180,000 between the two different types of Medicaid reimbursement. There's two. There's administrative outreach and then fee for service. We've now increased our reporting and increased the types of things we're able to claim. We're even claiming some transportation of students now. So our revenue this year exceeded $470,000. So we have kept these at stable levels.
So it's not that we're doing more. It's that we're documenting it better, recognizing when we can apply.
There is some additional work requests. So to claim some of this, you have to do some time studies. So there has been additional things.
But we're not doing more for
students, I'm sorry, Chris. No, it's more, it's the administrative side. There is some paperwork that goes into this that's pretty intensive. But it's really brought back, a great amount of resources back into our district.
Awesome.
And by the way, the National School Lunch, not knowing how the board was going to act, we did not change food service reimbursements or expense projections in the budget pending the outcome of the National School Lunch talk. So that will be a change between now and the final budget. You'll see those reimbursements go down, but you'll also see the amount we're sending to Quest for food service on the expense side go down.
It should be essentially a net zero effect.
Yeah, 7,000 it looks like the net effect will be.
Okay.
And more hummus.
And more hummus.
Go ahead.
The Perkins vocational grant.
Yeah.
Is that something we have to apply for, or is that something that the government sends for the?
We work with a cooperative of districts, so we feed into LEs, and both the CTEI and the Perkins grants are administered with that.
Okay, so coming through there, okay.
Same thing, it's the same that our special ed co-op manages all of the IDEA flow through in preschool. It initially goes there, and then we get the money back from them. They are the administrative agent for those grants.
I just thought it might have been a little low, so mm-hmm. I was just wondering.
Those have been fairly stable, both the CTEI and Perkins have been fairly stable.
Okay.
Even through some rough economic times, they've been able to support them.
Okay.
And the next page is just kind of summarizing the major changes from last year that we've already talked about. Other local revenue, we had two pretty sizable one-time revenues last year that are no more. So that's why you saw the big dip in other local revenue, even though some of it was offset because we did increase student fees for some of the one-to-one devices at the elementary level. General state aid, we talked about, it dropped by about $300,000because of switching formulas. And transportation reimbursement could be a lot higher, but we don't know state proration yet. That is all for revenue. So any other revenue questions, or when we start to get into the big summary at the very end, feel free to come back to it. So expenditures. The percent increases are pretty marginal as you go through salaries, benefits, and supply and services. Though the numbers are significant, a 1% increase in salaries is still $484,000. The big things here. So that we previewed staffing levels with you both in February, and then we touched on them again in May, and none of that has truly changed in this. This still has about 433 FTE of teachers built into it. I think our total FTE for the district is 673 or 693 between, that number is slipping my mind right now. But that takes in all paraprofessionals, custodians, the maintenance team, administrators, campus monitors and the like. Benefits, we knew that was going to be a larger increase, though we have seen some savings in some of the other areas of benefits. So the overall increase there was 4.03. Tuition and other objects is obviously the one that stands out here. At a budget of $5.5 million, but a 12% increase. And really what that is primarily, just under $5 million of that is out-of-district tuition. That's where we're sending students from our district to other outplacements, primarily for special needs students, although $300,000 for the Fox Valley Career Center is a part of that line item. The rest of this is between contingency funds that we have put throughout the budget. Because it's still July and things could change, we have added contingency to the education fund, the special education fund, the operations and maintenance fund, and the transportation fund to account for any things that may change over the last few months, or even if you adopt the budget with those contingency funds, unexpected things that could happen throughout the school year that those funds could account for. Like in the transportation fund, for instance, we were assuming two routes for STEM. However, we're kind of bouncing between two routes or three routes between, you know, how we're going to get students, you know, to the STEM school. So that could be an increase that you have to add back in as final routes are known. But anyways, non-capitalized equipment, that went down, as well as termination benefits. We've just basically put a placeholder of $30,000 for any unexpected that may come. So moving on, because we'll get back and see how the total expenses fit in with everything else. The next few pages, I've tried to kind of highlight how much you're spending on some of the major functions that we have. One thing to note here, you know, I'm not going to read the numbers to you because you can see them. Vocational instruction. Some of the staff members that teach our vocational classes seem to have been coded just into regular high school instruction. So that's something that we're going to try to work to make sure people get coded into the correct functions. We do spend more than $95,046 on the vocational programs that we have. But you can see, just for what we consider to be instructional expenses, is $45.25 million of the overall budget. So a great amount of funds simply go into instruction. We do include money that we pay for those special education outplacements there. Even though they're coded into a different area of the final budget, we did add them in here. The other areas of the budget that I've broken out by function, student services, administration. So related student services are those kind of pupil supports that are built in within our schools. So social workers, our counselors, psychologists, the nursing staff, speech pathologists, all go into related student services. Instructional support is often known as improvement of instruction, but that's where your curriculum and instruction division falls. Your learning resource centers are considered instructional support, so those are part of that line, along with our director of data and assessment. The costs associated with her duties fall into instructional support. Board of Education and superintendent, this is often a misleading line. But the Board of Education is the function where we budget for our workers' compensation insurance, our unemployment insurance, our property and casualty insurance, our legal fees, because all of those are functions of the board providing that type of insurance for the district. So that makes up the lion's share there, along with the costs of the Office of the Superintendent. Building administration would be the office of the principals and their staff, along with any building budgets that are focused on that administrative area. Finance would be the business office. Central office administration would include HR, communications, and technology. The other three, buildings and grounds, transportation, and food service, are relatively self-explanatory.
There's something I didn't think to ask earlier, Chris, just to clarify. So when you break these down by these functions, mm-hmm. obviously salaries are in there.
Yes.
But does that also scoop up other expenses for those departments?
Yes.
Or?
So, for example, food service. In previous things, I've said that the non-personnel food service should be around $903,000 or $915,000. The additional personnel cost would be the lunch aides, lunchroom aides that are included right here. Though what we showed in May had personnel all up in one area, and then I broke out the non-personnel costs somewhere else. This okay. is just kind of a different way of putting all of food service into the same line for you to see.
Okay. That's what
so this would be the cost of Quest, plus we do budget about $50,000 a year for various equipment repair or small wear replacement through our food service programs. If we have to replace a hot cart, you know, at the elementary school, that gets budgeted here.
So adding up all of our major expenses, and our, they should all sort of add up back to our total expenses, essentially.
Yes. And the food service number, that's a number that's going to be decreasing based on our vote tonight?
Yes, because previously we get charged on a per meal basis from Quest. Now we aren't being charged a thing at the high school, so it will have to, it will have to budget a different type of revenue and less expense at the high school. So. It wouldn't be a budget presentation if I didn't talk to you about your long-term debt. It's been one of my highlights here. We are in a very stable debt scenario for the next few years. It'll be right around 9.7 to 9.6 million. In about 3 or 4 years, it drops down to about 9.2 million as one of the payments starts to lower. And then it stays very steady through the 2025-2026 time frame. But this is very similar to what your debt looked like last year between principal and interest. One thing to note, the 2006 building bonds are no longer here. We have made the last payment on those. That was back in January, or December 31st. We did add the 2015 refunding bonds that we did earlier this year. Your next chance to refund any remaining debt would be early in 2016. In May, we talked a lot about the different type of personnel categories. We have detailed spreadsheets that give, you know, line item detail on every person that goes into these numbers. But here I've tried to keep them in somewhat big picture, knowing that we can tell you exactly what we're spending on teachers, we can tell you exactly what it is on paraprofessionals, secretaries, administrators. All of those go into regular salaries. So currently the budget is $43,278,000 for those 678 FTE of full-time employees. We do have budgeted about $510,000 for substitutes or like seasonal work. And then extra and overtime accounts for $1.9 million. Extra and overtime both includes, overtime is pretty obvious, but any extra duties that our teaching staff or our support staff engage in. So when they work on committees, when they take on a coaching stipend or direct a music a group, all of those go into extra. So the regular salaries should simply be their base pay, should be very easy to track on a person-by-person basis. Extra and overtime gets a little bit more subjective because we're predicting how much extra work will be done.
Can I?
Yes.
All right, on the, maybe I wrote a number down wrong. On the regular salaries to 43 million?
Yes.
You're saying 678 is full-time teachers?
No. Right. Full-time equivalent okay. of employees in the district.
And then the
433
is what we have okay. Currently budgeted for right. licensed right. teaching right. staff.
All right. Wanted just to make sure.
You can see the benefits on the other side. Pension benefits, everything aggregated into that would be payments that we make, the employer portion of TRS, the employer portion of IMRF, the employer portion of Social Security and Medicare. Insurance benefits, are I previously called them fringe benefits, but that's where you get into life insurance, medical insurance, dental, vision, long-term disability, those types of things. Other benefits would be tuition reimbursement to staff and any contributions to a flex spending plan.
Do you have a grasp on how closely or how steadily we've held as that total personnel cost as a percentage of our budget?
I can find that out with not too much effort.
I would just be curious yeah. sort of historically how we're holding the line on that.
This number dropped slightly from last year because obviously I used this same template, so I was editing numbers within here. Okay. It was just over 72 last year in the budget.
Okay.
But you know, final audited numbers might have been a little different here. So.
Okay.
And I seem to recall, I mean, does it look like our substitute temporary salaries have decreased?
No, I wouldn't say that they've decreased. Especially, we've had some leave of absences that have, you know, extended, and we've seen increased costs there. But no, I wouldn't say that I've seen, we've seen a decrease in substitute costs.
So I thought with us going to more teacher institute days being implemented, that, or like half day type of protocols,
it's
that
it's
coming.
Yeah, that's coming.
So okay, we've budgeted based off of last year's actuals. So yeah, we
so
made
we
no adjustments.
So we may see
good,
a
yes.
positive.
That's what we made.
Non-personnel expenses. On the left, you can see all of the building budget allocations that they were given. On the right, those are some of the major contracts that we had that hit our budget. Again, food service, that will change before they adopt it. But the Chromebook leases combined are $934,000. In addition to that, the computer leases for staff and those remaining, you know, carts that are there, $332,000. Custodial services, that's a decrease. Mr. Brown has been working with them to try to even find more ways to be efficient. I don't think it's a final agreement on exactly how the contract will be, but right now he's budgeting $786,000 there. And then you can see we do have you know, large utility bills. Natural gas, I believe, went down slightly. Electricity went up slightly. So as we continue to evaluate the energy savings contracts that were opened, possibly there could be some ways to save on electricity through this year. Transportation, we project that between the various routes and extracurriculars, that contract will be worth $4.2
million. Am I correct in thinking we cut building budgets this year?
We did, building and department budgets. We reduced by 10%, not knowing what the state was going to do. And so for now, we've held those. That's also why some of that contingency money is there, that as administration gets near the end of the budget, if they decide that they can release some things back, the funds could be there to support
that. Paper if we run out.
Yeah.
Pens.
Tuition payments is the next slide. Oh, go ahead.
Just got a hand raised.
I've got my hand raised. That Chromebook lease?
Yes.
That is for the full total amount for elementary?
Yes.
For everybody?
That's not just the new one.
Just not the new ones.
Yeah, that's the combined amounts between the second year payments from what was authorized in 2014.
Second year payments.
And then the first year payment on what was just authorized here in 2015.
But then parents also cover half.
Yes. So that, if you recall during discussion of other local revenue.
Right. So that
we saw a drop of $700,000, but then, so I'm booking the entire expense here because I'm also booking the entire revenue somewhere else.
Okay. So half of that is covered. Somewhere
yes.
else. Okay.
Yes.
That's
that's a good question.
Okay.
Just got to
think.
Right. You're just trying to figure out the net cost to us. What?
Major tuitions that we budget for, Mid Valley Special Ed. So the IDEA grant covers just under half of our tuition in Mid Valley. We do have a couple of large private placements between our ED students and our students with autism. Private health impaired is also a large line item that we have. Fox Valley Career Center, like I said earlier, was $300,000. That's a large increase over last year, but that's based on student signups. So, yes?
Okay, I have not seen any, and I'm not sure where I would see it. Maybe I don't. Like, tuition payment, like to the STEM?
Where is that?
Where would I?
I didn't, we didn't budget for that under this tuition, like again,
okay.
This right now. That would be, I think currently we.
Where does that come out of? Do you know?
The staff members were already there. So the staff members are within our FTE count. And then we increased a couple of the accounts within, I can't remember if it was a building budget or a department budget to account
down.
For the additional money that we anticipated we'd have to send to the
So I'm not going to see it as a line item on tuition payment.
It could end up being its own line
someday.
Item for tuition.
Someday.
Right now we put placeholders in until we start getting invoices and figure out exactly where we want to put the funds within the accounts.
I guess, because I would expect to see it.
Right. I think when we mm-hmm. when we saw Fox Valley Career Center, we were like, wait, why isn't the STEM to go
sure.
there? So
okay.
Not that we're trying to dance for you, we're just confused.
No.
No.
We don't have to pay for it, but being better.
Major capital projects, you've seen this before. Mr. Bowen already updated you on a lot of these things. Again, I asked all departments to actually reduce their budgets to plan for what the state might do. One of the biggest places that Mr. Brown has kind of held back is currently there's only $1.32 million in his budget. We'd like that to be 1.5. That's what the overall plan was, but there's $200,000 of contingency within the O&M fund. So if things pan out to where we get all the revenues that are expected and you can release those funds, I'm sure there are projects that could be completed. So now you get to the big spreadsheet with smaller numbers because we're trying to get everything on there. But like I said, last year, we're predicting that the year end last year will be just under $2 million pending what the auditors do with property taxes. And so even though we saw revenues decrease from last year, the inherent surplus was enough to offset an increase of expenses of $1.8 million. To where we're currently projecting a surplus of just under $90,000, $87,919. But keep in mind, there is $650,000 of contingency built into the budget. So if you take those out, your surplus looks a lot higher.
So is this section of the presentation the same as this
it
other?
It should be this is the operating summary by object, so it's the second page of
Oh,
that.
Right. I'm just wondering, yes. Is it the same information or is one more updated than
no,
the other?
No, it should be the same information. If you find a number that's different, it's because it just was typed in wrong, so it's supposed to be the same.
Yeah, it should be.
I was just going to ignore that one if it's all the same information for now. So.
All right, Chris, I know you've already answered this. On the operating summary by object, other local, which I made a note, is fees,
rentals,
other stuff.
Yes.
You probably already answered this. We voted last month to raise elementary school fees.
Yes.
We doubled them. You're showing me a decrease of 7.1%.
There were two one-time revenues that we got last year that fall into this category. The first was a surplus distribution from the expired Aurora TIF that was about $434,000.
Okay.
The second was, that is where we always budgeted the insurance rebate from the previous health insurance plan that we had. Both of those go away, so that's over like $750,000 that dropped in other local revenue. Then it was offset a little by the increase in student fees. So the increase is there. We did increase our projected student fees for next year. So that's why instead of a $700,000 drop in other local revenue, it's only showing $328,000.
But we pay some of that forward on the Google contract, the Chromebook contract, right?
Yes, they're just two separate, they're two separate accounts. So we have to show the revenue in one and the expense in the other.
Right. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Last slide actually just brings it all together. The only thing that you haven't seen already is we did budget $7,000 of land cash fees in the capital projects fund. The city did increase the value of land per acre. And we also had notification from Kane County that they had some slight subdivision of a property into multiple parcels. And so we are expecting some small distribution of land cash from Kane County. Their process is a little different, so we actually have to formally, the board has to approve a request for them to distribute their land cash. So that'll be something for us to complete. But this now brings in the debt service fund and the little bit that's in capital projects. Again, we budget for all our capital projects. Because we're spending operating revenues, we put all of our projects in the operations and maintenance fund. We leave the capital projects fund for projects that have a restricted revenue source, such as bonds when we had a referendum, or if we get developer impact fees, we would put them into the capital projects fund and disperse them from there. That concludes the budget presentation. So what other questions can I answer? Otherwise, we'll get into timeline and the action item for this evening. Okay, well then, I know questions may still come, but I'll go ahead and talk timeline as other thoughts may percolate. So tonight, we do need the action of formally putting this on public display, which means we'll have a few printed copies out by the front lobby. But more importantly, we will get it, all of these documents, including the state form, posted to the website for public view and for people to submit comments ahead of your public hearing. That's the second part of your action item, is to set the public hearing on this budget for August 25th, slight typo in the agenda. I believe you said it was going to be at 7 p.m., not 6 p.m., so your action item needs to specifically say 7 p.m. on August 25th here at this address. Pending that action item, tomorrow morning I will get the legal notice sent off to the paper, as well as get these things on the website. On August 25th, you'll hold your public hearing, but there is no further action. Administration will give you any other updates that have happened on the budget since then. You are currently scheduled to adopt the budget then about 27 days later on September 22nd at your regularly scheduled meeting in September. The only statutory requirement for that is you have to adopt it before September 30th.
Is there a limit, since we're putting it up for public display, on the amount of changes that we can make?
Actually, no.
Okay.
Because it's simply in tentative form. If major edits are made prior to the public hearing, we can, at least modify the document that is online and note that it was revised on this date. But there's no statutory requirement to do another publication that changes have been made.
Okay.
Because it's known, it's one of the things that the General Assembly did right with schools, that they didn't require you to adopt it by July 1st, the start of your fiscal year, because so much of your educational planning may change during the months of July and August, that they give you until the end of September to codify that into your formal budget.
And everyone has the opportunity at the next meeting to bring back, as you're looking through this and realizing, oh wait, there's stuff I didn't really understand, or now that I'm looking at it, we have another opportunity to discuss that. You can bring back any of these questions. We can revisit anything that doesn't seem clear anymore after we walk out of this room.
This is what's going on public display?
The official thing that goes on public display will be this state budget form and the budget summary that I also put on. But I'm also going to make sure that that presentation is up there for anyone that wants to see it.
Can we request more information?
Always.
Okay. I would like to see a breakdown, personally. Under the major expense function, services administration, I would like to see something that's not just a raw number for building administration, central office administration, buildings and grounds. I'm just concerned that if I were a member of the public and I'm looking at this very summarized document, that there really isn't that much to discuss. And maybe there isn't anything to discuss. But I've got a raw number. I've got raw numbers without much explanation. So I would be personally interested in some more itemized breakdowns. As for example, central office administration, how much we're paying for administrative assistants versus how much we're paying for the technology department versus how much we're paying for X, Y, and Z.
We have all of that information. So
I know you do. I'm sure you
do. It's a great deal of information, so we generally have not put all of that on the web because there are 20,000 line items that could go into the expenses.
Right.
But anyone in the public is welcome to request detailed information about any of this. So.
Okay. So I'll send you a request then for just certain things.
Great.
Okay. So my neighbor, though, would want to go to the website, school district website, and pull up the itemized. Where would they find that?
It'll be on the finance portion of the, so if you go to our BPS101.net website, under the finance division, you will see an area for budgets. Yeah, Brad is doing this right now.
Okay, so hang on.
Finance and business.
It'll be there.
Yeah, it's not live.
BPS 101 annual budgets.
It is.
See? Okay.
Yeah, it'll be there.
Yeah, and again, this website was just redone, but I will work with them to actually just have it on that landing page for finance and business, because five clicks to get to it is not very helpful. It'd be nice if just one would get there.
It should be on the homepage for the next couple of weeks.
Right, it'll be in the board highlights. And
right. I think that's going to be the landing page.
Right.
Well, yeah, but you might have to go there.
There'll be plenty of ways for people to
get
to it.
Just come in and get our copy.
Right.
I could always stop in. We have copies.
Any other questions about the tentative budget or about our timeline?
No, Chris answered some questions from the
Okay, and again, this is not the last time we'll be discussing it, and it won't be the last time you can ask questions. So really what we're looking at tonight, again, is just the step of putting it on display and then setting our public hearing. So yeah, and Chris won't be answering any of the questions.
Chris won't be answering any more questions.
No, I will still be calling him and asking questions.
You've all got myself.
That he's changing.
And he just said
that he's now blocked our numbers.
You just put that on camera. I mean, come on.
So if there's no other questions, then I would entertain a motion to place the fiscal year 2015-16 budget on display in tentative form, and that we set the public hearing on said budget for 7 o'clock p.m. on August 25th, 2015 at the Rosalie M. Jones Administration Center, 335 West Wilson, Batavia, Illinois.
That's going to be still part of our regular board meeting, though.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
There's going to be, so there'll be ample time for anybody to say whatever they wanted to.
Historically, you would start the meeting by starting the public hearing.
Right.
Okay. I just wanted
and then
clarify.
Adjourn
okay.
that,
close
and then begin
the
your
public
regular,
hearing, and then begin
continue your regular.
Okay.
That's
right. Okay.
Right.
Just,
really
I just wanted to make sure.
We had passed, but then we sat here for 45 minutes.
Yeah.
So we just decided that starting it at 7 o'clock, and we can, yeah.
So okay. Moved.
Second.
Moved by Locke, second by Stoops.
Sorry.
Moved by Locke, second by Stoops.
Oh, okay.
And then would you please call the roll? Mrs. Capini.
Okay,
Blakey.
Yeah.
Dryden.
Aye.
Casper.
Yes.
Locke.
Yes.
Lowe.
Yes.
Stoops.
Yes.
Drummond.
Yes. Excellent. Moving along. We are very efficient tonight. We will move to administration comments. Dr. Hitchett.
Great. A couple things. Our next board meeting is August 11th, which is the board self-evaluation. I would like to also put, just take a couple minutes to have you guys vote on a personnel report that'll be similar to what you would normally vote on. But as we're making some of these last minute hires, we have some jobs posted right now. It would be nice to tell the people that they actually have the job on August 11th instead of waiting till after the school year starts. So. Mr. Pierce has recommended or has asked if you can put one agenda item on your meeting before you get to your self-evaluation, which is closed session.
And we will entertain public comments. That
say that again. Start it.
So August 11th, we have your board self-evaluation meeting. It's that part of the meeting is closed session, but we always start our meetings in open session with public comment.
Okay.
And I would also like to make a request that we vote on a personnel report so that the people that we need to start for the school year could get hired prior to the start of the school year.
So we're still starting at 7. We're just adding an action.
Correct.
Yeah.
So
but we're trying
start
to
at 7, go into close.
Well, we'll start at 7. We'll do the one action item. We'll do the
public
comment.
Okay, action item,
one
close
action
session.
Item.
Okay.
We generally try to limit that so that we have ample time for us to work together as a board on that, but in the interest of expediency for our new hires. We will have one action.
Is it the same lady that we worked with before that's coming in?
The helper lady, not
there were two here?
What did you say?
The helper lady, not the one who's
There were two people that from IASB that came last time. One of them was in training. She is the one that will be doing the workshop. Laura Martinez is her name for the IASB. She is the one assigned to our region.
Okay.
So we'll work with her to finalize the agenda or to finalize her topics and get that out. So also in August, speaking of vacancies and personnel reports, Chris, thank you very much for years of service.
It's been an honor.
You will be missed. not to talk about you before you left, but you are leaving, and we do need to fill the CSBO position. Every school district needs to have a school business official to do things, just as, you know, to present these reports, just as Chris has. So we'll be making a recommendation to you within the next couple weeks of how we would like to proceed with that position. In the interim, if anybody has any questions, Chris's last day with us is Thursday, so Lindsay is obviously here, and Pat, for your questions, and Tony and Glacey also, who's not here tonight, will also be stepping in. All three of them actually have their CSBO endorsements, so they're all very qualified to answer your questions, and I'm always available as well for any questions about the budget. So you could always go with, send your questions to me if anybody has any questions, and between all of the rest of the team, we'll get them answered, but you'll be missed.
Thank you.
And last thing, the maintenance facility. We do have an open house that's open to the public. It's next Wednesday at 9 a.m. We have so many people that are asking about it, curious to see what's going on in there. So anybody is welcome to come at 9 a.m. next Wednesday to the maintenance shop.
What's going on in there?
It's
9
a.m.
Is it?
9 a.m. That's it for me.
Excellent. Then we'll go to board comments. We'll start down here with Mr. Dryden tonight.
Oh, I have nothing to add. Thank you.
Excellent. Thanks.
I just want to thank Chris for his years of service and for always being available to answer questions and help me get through.
Chris.
I just want to say congratulations to Chris Pond and thanks and good luck.
Thank you.
And that I have no update on the Park District because their meeting is going on right now.
So
we don't normally. I think this is the only time that we are going to conflict all year.
Okay, good.
So I missed their meeting, but I did want to let everybody know that they do have business cards, in case anybody was wondering.
We were. Thank you.
And that is all.
Jason. Those were not budgets.
You know, I wish Chris all the best of luck. It's not goodbye. It's until we see you again. I'm sure. So, I knew you were destined for this progression and greatness, and I'm sure you're going to do very well in your new position, as you've done great here. So I've learned a lot from you coming in, you know, 2 years ago, and I appreciate all your work and patience and teaching me the financials of the district and how to really understand.
I didn't see you at FSB.
Even though I was literally a ghost, I guess, at all of our financial meetings. I did not go to the City Council meeting on Monday because I was at Barrington High School for the entrepreneurial program that we're rolling out at the high school, and I'm a coach and mentor, so I had some training to do there. It's a very exciting program. I'm looking forward to coaching and mentoring these students in their programs, and I hope everyone's having a safe and happy summer now that it's finally getting to summer weather, and go Bulldogs.
Thanks, Jason. Tina?
I don't have anything except you. Best of luck, Chris.
Thanks, Steve.
Jeff,
all you, John.
Basically the same thing. I mean, I really would have liked to have, you know, on the selfish part is deny your resignation until after the budget is completed. But I understand how things work, and I would never vote against anybody going for another job or retiring, and I do wish you well. I know it's something you've been looking forward to, and of course the timing's not great for us. I do have concerns about what's going to happen, and I'll bring that up at a later date. So, thank you.
Thanks, John. Good luck, Chris. You will be missed.
Thank you very much.
And just a little side comment, I had the privilege of sitting in on a site visit that Winoka did to come and grill us about how Chris really was, and I was incredibly impressed to hear how much your staff really admired and respected you, and we don't often get to hear that real feedback, and so it was just really kind of made it worse that you came, but it was nice, and I wish you all the luck, and I think Winoka is going to be just the absolutely perfect place for you.
Thank you.
Can't be here.
It's been an absolute honor to work for this board, the previous board, this community, the staff. Terrific place. Thank you.
Well, good luck. And we have no closed session tonight, so I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Gasper, second by Stoops. All in favor?
Aye.
We are adjourned.